Hey everybody, thank you so much for tuning in to another episode with me, William Wallace, and my show, William Wallace for America. As you know, I love interviewing not only our legislators and elected officials around the state to find things that we can unite on, but find things that are solutions for our state. And today, I'm with State Rep Richard Nelson, District 89, over here in Mandeville. You're gonna see a nice background behind us. We've got a great view of the lake. He says it's the best view there is on the North Shore. But you're not going to see a smoke-filled room. And if you are knowing where this video is going, you're going to get that joke, because we're going to talk about his legislation in just a minute about legalizing marijuana. But before we talk about that, which is a hot topic, of course, before we talk about that, I want to ask him the questions I ask all the other reps, but we're going to do it a lot quicker because we really want to get to the smoke-filled room. Oh, I mean, no, we're not going to get to the smoke-filled room. But we're going to talk about it some more. Representative, thanks so much for coming on. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, no worries.
So tell us a little bit about your district. What makes up your district? What are the actual boundaries of your district?
So my district is basically Mandeville with a slight little piece of unincorporated Covington and Madisonville. Basically runs from Fountain Blue State Park to the Chafunta River in the west, and basically south of I-12. So anything that little kind of rectangle, that's my district. So it's pretty small, pretty conservative, and right here on the lake, so it's not too bad.
Very distinct boundaries.
Yeah, no, it's perfect. Yeah, I can write it off in a few seconds.
So people from this area know this is like residential, family, suburban life. There's no chemical industry. There's no big business over here. It's just residential and shopping.
Yep.
That's the main thing. So what? So talk to me about your background. Let's talk about where you're coming from and your education and what your career was before you became a state rep.
Yeah, so I grew up here in Mandeville. I went to Mandeville High. I went to LSU, got a degree in biological engineering. Went to LSU Law School, got a law degree. And then I joined the Foreign Service of the State Department. Spent 7 years traveling all around the world as a diplomat and a security engineering officer, basically protecting embassies overseas from terrorism and espionage. So did that for 7 years. I was in Washington, D.C., Germany and the Republic of Georgia, a little country south of Russia. Then I came back to D.C., and then after that, I came back here to Mandeville. I was actually supposed to move to Nairobi, Kenya, and I was able to come back here and, you know, decided to run for office. So
that's quite a history, quite a lot of experience under your belt.
Yeah, I've seen a good part of the world and the bad parts too. So it's okay.
Now you went to law school, but what was your undergraduate degree in?
Biological engineering.
So you've got, just like I said, a diverse set of education behind you.
Yeah, my son says I'm a problem solver. When people ask him, what does he do? My dad solves problems. That's what he says. So
that's a unique way of doing it. Well, yeah. It's better to be known as a problem solver,
yeah,
you know, than a problem starter, I guess.
Yeah, that's right. It's not too bad.
So what made you run for office?
So I followed the news. Well, you know, I kind of tracked everything while I was living overseas and in the State Department. And, you know, I feel like you kind of constantly get, you know, worse and worse news out of Louisiana. Like, you never really read a headline that's like, hey, things are really turning around here. Things are really going good. Most of my friends that I went to high school with, most of them have left the state. A lot of them that I went to undergrad with, a lot of them have left the state too. And they're just looking for better opportunity. So, I mean, it really was something for me that, you know, this is my home. This is, you know, what I care about. And I felt like if I could, was perfectly happy, I could have stayed away and not come back. But I thought that, you know, if I felt like I had the ability to come back and do something and change it, that I had to, you know, because if I don't do something, who is, right? And so I told my wife, I was like, hey, how about we, you know, leave the Foreign Service, come back to Louisiana. And
was she also the Foreign Services?
No, she was, you know, she was with me. We had we had our first two sons while we were in the Foreign Service. So okay. That's a full-time job for her. But I told her, I was like, look, I think this is something that I really need to do. I really care a lot about Louisiana. I really care a lot about the people here. And I feel like they need somebody to come and make sure, you know, come and fight for them, basically. You know, I think, you know, Louisiana's been number 50 for so long, and we just kind of keep going down. I mean, we used to be able to fight with Mississippi, and now Mississippi's pulling ahead. And really, it's not the people, you know, it's not the resources, it's not the place. Like, it's just the policies that hold us back. And I mean, a lot of it is historical. It's been here for a long time. But, you know, that's really what we have to fight. And I felt like I could do something about it, and I had to.
So. Things that worked 50, 60, 70 years ago aren't working today. And it takes people with your unique skill set, you know, working with other people in the legislature with their unique skill sets to not only be the problem solver, but find new policies that bring us into the future that take us from 50, you know, from number 50. I mean, look, even to number 40 or 30 would be a huge change, you know, in there.
Yeah. So, I mean, I think if we move from 50 to 25, right? So we jump just to average. If we were just average, it's like everyone in Louisiana would live three more years and they would make 40% more in income. So, I mean, it's a huge runway to get up to improve, right? And you just need the policies to do it.
So with that kind of thinking there and that kind of skill set, what do you think is the biggest problem Louisiana faces that you want to tackle with your skill set?
I mean, I think the high-level problem is I think we are too accepting of the status quo. I think that we really have to reject, you know, the historical policies that we've had, and we really have to believe that we can change them. That's the big problem, is that if everybody just said one day, and, you know, I think most people know. They know things need to change. They know it needs to be different. But I think a lot of them just kind of cynically say, you know what, this is Louisiana. We're never going to change it. And so really what we have to do is get beyond that and say, actually, we can change anything. Anything can change any day. Like, that's why we have it. That's why we have a legislature. Everything, all these rules can be changed. We put this on ourselves. So I think that mindset is really what holds us back.
Getting beyond the status quo.
Yeah, and I think the actual policies, I think the tax system is really broken, and it's broken in two ways. One, it really taxes success with the income tax. I mean, we're right next to Texas, which has 0% income tax on corporate and personal. I think it just drives successful companies away. So that's part of the problem. But the other problem is that just the way the tax structure is set up is that it concentrates too much power in Baton Rouge. And so basically the job as a state representative or state senator is to go to Baton Rouge to beg for the people's money back, right?
Right.
That's how it's set up. It's not, hey, these local problems can be addressed locally, that here in Mandeville, if we want a new road, we could raise our, you know, have property taxes that pay for our new roads so that we don't have to ask people in Shreveport to pay for it, and the other way around, right? So what we have now is that we created this, you know, disproportionately large centralized state government that we all have to go to and beg to get our local projects done. Even in a place that's relatively wealthy like Mandeville, we still have to go ask for money because we don't necessarily have the means to support ourselves because of the tax structure and how it's set up.
And you got some legislation to fix that, right?
Yes, I have a constitutional amendment.
So here's what I'm going to do, because we know what the main topic is. We're going to save that one for last. So let's real quick get your legislation that you got coming up that you think is going to fix some of these problems. Tell them about your other legislation, and then we're going to talk about legalizing marijuana.
Yeah, so I have some bills to get rid of the income tax and the corporate income tax and kind of rework some of the structure to decentralize the power back to local governments. So I have that, and I think that's really the answer to a lot of Louisiana's problems. I have that, and then I actually have a bill to change the state motto or kind of adopt a state motto. So currently it's Union, Justice, Confidence, which really doesn't make any sense to me. And I don't think there's any really real good history on why it's that. It's just been there for a long time. But there was actually a competing motto from the 1800s that was, we live and die for those we love, which is a description of the seal and the flag, you know, the pelican with their
babies. Chest.
So she's plucking, she's plucking the feathers from her breast to feed the babies. And that was a description of that over the years. It's actually a medieval Christian symbol. And it was, you know, similar to that. We live and die for those we love. It's actually a version of that's on the side of the state capitol. It's also on the Louisiana law license underneath the seal. It says, I live and die for those I love. So it's got a lot of connection to Louisiana history. I think it makes a much better motto, and I think better explains who we are as a people versus Union, Justice, Confidence, which really is just kind of three words that don't really mean a lot to anybody, I think.
But especially when many people don't have confidence in our government.
So maybe it's aspirational that we have confidence one day and that we'll have justice one day, and, you know, union, I don't know. But so I think that was really a bill that I brought just kind of to bring to light that idea of, hey, look, there's things that have been around for a long time that don't really make a lot of sense. Maybe we can do something about it.
So. And one thing I'm going to point out about that, you gave me something to think about here, is that sometimes the process or the laws that other reps are bringing forward, some people might not like them, some people might love them, but the reality is the process of bringing them forth helps get things out, gets new information out, helps people think a little bit differently. So maybe a bill might not go through the way you want it to, but the process might help open some doors in the future to help good ideas come in a little bit more. Would you say that's the case?
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, you know, a lot of times you bring bills that are not going to fail, right?
Right.
But what you want to do is introduce the concept, and you want to get people thinking in that way. And that's half the battle, right?
So, yeah, absolutely.
You always want your bill to pass. You want the governor to sign it, but it doesn't always work out that way.
So state sales tax, and what are your other legislation that you want to talk about?
I have another bill that's basically gets rid of the sentence of juvenile life without parole. So Louisiana is one of the only states that still will say if a child commits a crime that we'll throw them in jail for forever. So I have a bill that would basically put us in line with most of the other states, where if you get convicted of even a murder or something like that when you're 15, mm-hmm. that after 25 years in jail, that you can be considered for release through parole, parole process. So that's the only one I have besides my, of course, marijuana legislation.
Well, I like the fact that more people think about criminal justice reform. I think that goes hand in hand, not just with public safety, but also with our prison systems and our legal system to be able to help, like I said, not accepting the status quo, but find ways to be able to move forward in a positive direction and help out people, like I said, that we live and die for.
Yeah.
I
mean, Louisiana has the highest incarceration rate in the world.
Yeah. So not that I'm saying that there's a connection between living and dying, but with people for that.
You'd rather live them. You'd rather have them live. Yeah.
Exactly. But we all share the same society, and we have to do it right. And sometimes, like I said, choosing a law or choosing the direction might not be the outcome, but the process helps reform in ways that satisfies our body and the community and helps our state.
Absolutely.
In a way. Speaking of which, let's talk about marijuana.
Yeah.
So you came up with the bill to legalize marijuana.
Yeah, so my bill would actually put it to the people, right? It's a vote of the people to say.
Oh, so it's not just saying,
no,
hey,
it's not the politicians telling
it?
You. No, it's not the politicians telling you what to do. It's the people, giving the people the option to do it. So there was a poll out recently that said about 67% of Louisiana supports legalization. I've never smoked marijuana. I wouldn't recommend it, but
I
recognize that people do it, right? It's widespread. It's probably in every high school in the state.
Right.
So I acknowledge the reality of it. And I just think that it would be safer, or it would be better for everybody. And as a society, it'd be better to have it be safe and regulated. And then also to make sure that money that right now is going to the drug dealers and the cartels, that we actually keep that in the state, we use it in legitimate businesses, and we tax it so that we can do things like pay for our police, fix our roads, improve our schools, those things that we could really use that money in the state of Louisiana to do some good things. I think it's a much better policy to have it be taxed and taxed and safe and regulated than it is to have it unregulated and funding the black market.
I like something you said earlier about knowing that younger people are buying it, but let's not talk about younger people. Let's just talk about people in general, whether that you're the younger person that's buying it behind your parents' back, so to speak, or the older person that's buying it someplace. They're buying it from drug dealers right now.
Yes,
basically. And something you said earlier was that if we make it legal, you can know who you're buying it from.
Yeah, that's right. So, and under my proposed...
It's safer.
Yeah, under my proposed legislation, it's still going to be illegal for anyone under 21 to buy it, right?
Okay.
So you're going to have to be 21.
Like alcohol.
Yeah, just like alcohol. But you're going to be buying it from a store, and it's going to have to have been laboratory tested to tell you, what's the content of THC? Does it have any pesticides or any of those other things in it? So it'll be safe. You'll know what you're buying,
right?
As opposed to when you buy it from a drug dealer, you don't know if it's laced with fentanyl or something that might kill you. You don't know what they use to grow it. There's no recourse if something happens to you when you use it, versus if you do it, from a legal store, they have, all the repercussions of a normal business. So it makes it much safer. It makes the people much safer, the customers much safer. And, you don't have to be involved in the underground market, the black market, where it's just inherently dangerous, right?
Exactly.
Because if they have a dispute, they can't settle it in a court. You have a dispute, they settle it with a gun. And I don't want my kids ever being involved with that. I don't want them to smoke marijuana. I'm going to do my best to make sure they don't. But at the same time, if they were, I'd rather it be safe and regulated and not involve a drug dealer. So,
well, it's just like alcohol. Alcohol, you don't want your kids drinking alcohol when they're underage or making that decision. But if you raise them right and you teach them the right from wrong, you have less of a chance that they're going to abuse alcohol. And the same, I guess, would go for marijuana.
Absolutely.
Something you said a minute ago, do you think that legalizing it would lower crime?
Obviously, it would probably significantly impact the crime of possession of marijuana because it would no longer be a crime, right? I think if you look at the states that have legalized it in the past, there's not been a huge drop in violent crime. Like, it really didn't impact it that much. At the same time, Louisiana is a relatively violent state. So, we have more crime and more, we throw more people in jail than anybody else.
Right.
To my knowledge, there's nobody that fits, there's no state that's legalized it so far that really fits in the mold of what Louisiana is. So I think it'd be difficult to say, would we have, you know, would we not have a significant decrease in crime? Right. I think it might be more significant than other states just because of the, you know, I think the amount of crime that we experience now, that legalizing marijuana would probably have a much more positive impact.
So help our state. You know, we can't compare it to other states all the time. But yeah, in our case, because our crime is so high, you think it might have an impact of lowering crime.
Yeah, I think it would have a disproportionate impact because I think that you know, kind of the drug trade really fuels a lot of that crime. And I think when you get rid of a significant portion of that and shift it to the, you know, the regular market, the free market, I think it would be a significant improvement in the crime.
Well, I can see where it would increase safety and lower crime. I can see the benefits, yeah, you know, of that. It's funny because, you know, the idea for many states was to decriminalize marijuana before they actually legalize it. So I want to go through that process with you. We talked about earlier about the making the jump, just go ahead and legalize it opposed to decriminalize it. Yeah. And there was a reason for that.
Yeah, so I mean, I think if you decriminalize it, right, I mean, you still leave the drug dealers and the cartels in business. That's the problem. Mm-hmm. You still leave it so that people have to buy it on a black market that's not regulated. So you don't know what you're buying. You don't know if you don't know if it's got laced with something that's going to kill you.
Right.
So you don't really solve any of those problems. The only thing you do is you reduce the number of people you throw in jail for it. That's what it is. And so I think
which lowers our costs on our state.
Yeah, it does have a positive impact, but it doesn't solve the significant problems, I think.
Right.
Plus, I think the tax portion of it, that when you're able to tax this, that's a whole nother ballgame. Of you're talking about $200 million a year. So just getting
revenue
for the state, just tax revenue, right?
So you think the revenue could generate $200 million more in revenue
if
just
you
to legalize marijuana?
$200 million a year. Yeah, that's the projection. So over the first five years, it's going to be about $1 billion. And so it'll continue to increase after that because it's going to take some time to ramp up, right? But over the first 5 years, it's $1 billion. And so when you're looking at like whether legalization will have that big of an effect, you know, it's most states, it really doesn't affect a lot of those, violent crime and all those parameters. But when you look at taking that money and investing it into things like law enforcement, investing it into schools and investing into roads, that's where you really start to see the return on investment. You really see those returns come out, right? Because you may be, you know, legalizing across the board doesn't improve everything significantly. But when you take $40 million a year and you say, hey, NOPD, why don't you go hire another 20 officers to go, you know, patrol the city, keep people safe. And you do that across the state, right? When you give them an extra $40 million to go hire law enforcement, I think that makes a big difference in, you know, how they're going to solve the crimes and that, you know, how much the crime rates are going to go down just from that money that extra investment. And then you still have all the, you know, like I said, $1 billion over 5 years. That pays for a lot of roads, that fixes a lot of potholes, that you know, will pay a lot for a lot of teachers, you know. Yeah, so I mean, I think there's a very clear trade-off here, and that's why in my tax portion of the legalization bill, I dedicated 20% to law enforcement. So it's a very clear trade-off.
Well, I was asking about that. So in a time when, you know, a lot of legislators are arguing about how some certain funds are dedicated and put into lock boxes, and now we can't get into those lock boxes where the money is, you know, kind of thing, whether it's good or bad about that. You know, we could always talk about how when gambling was going to be legalized, you know, like another, you know, thing that a lot of people didn't like.
Yeah.
You know, it was sold as a way to fund schools, to give money back to schools. And of course, the complaint is now that, you know, it's still not doing all of that. You know,
yeah.
Is there a way to dedicate these funds? And I guess you're alluding to that you're doing that already. How does that happen where we can say, okay, you know, if it's legalized, this is going to be dedicated and guaranteed that this money's always going to go to law enforcement?
So the way that I have it set up right now is it's kind of both worlds, right? So 50% of the revenue is going to go to the local governments and 50% of the revenue is going to go to the state general fund. So the 50% that goes to the state general fund is totally undedicated right now. We can use it for everything, right? So we can use it to pay for schools if we want to pay for schools. We can use it to pay for roads if we want to pay for roads. And I think having that flexibility and ability to prioritize makes for better policy. I mean, I think it really helps in saying we're going to fund the priorities, right? And those priorities change every year, and we're not going to lock our hands for the next 20 years because of the decision we made today.
Right.
So I think that's good. At the same token, 50% is going to go to the local governments. And the way that I have it set up is that 20% will be dedicated to law enforcement. So we'll either go to the sheriff specifically, if it's in if the dispensary is located in an unincorporated part of the parish, or if it's in a municipality, it will go to that municipality for law enforcement. The other 30% is unrestricted. They can spend it on however they would like. And, you know, I think it's good because one of the big arguments against marijuana, I think, is that it will lead to a deterioration of law and order. So I think having that direct investment back into law enforcement so that it, you can see it's going to pay for more police to be there.
Right.
Like, it directly will pay for that. I think that kind of gets around that argument of, hey, look, if we legalize marijuana, it's going to lead to this kind of, you know, chaos and law.
Right.
It's like, no, actually, we're going to give $40 million a year or so to specifically support law and order. That's not going to be paid for by homeowners or, you know, people
right.
who are buying toilet paper, right? So it's a huge thing, I think, would significantly impact, you know, the safety and safety outside of the regular arguments. Yeah,
there's an argument by some law enforcement that, you know, some law enforcement will say they don't, the reason they don't want marijuana legalized is because it helps them in traffic stops and other things to be able to find criminals that are on the run just by simply, you know, finding marijuana on the person or smelling it or whatever the case may be. Mm-hmm. That having marijuana illegal helps them make more arrests.
Yeah, so I mean, obviously, I think having them, they're right that it does, it makes it a lot easier to arrest people when marijuana is illegal because it's really just widespread in the community. So anyone you want to arrest
right.
probably has marijuana on them, and you can,
yeah.
if you search, you'll find it, right? If you seek and you shall find. but at the same time, what you really want them to do is focus on finding the robbers and the murderers and burglars
exactly.
and all
yeah.
those guys that really impact people's lives. Those are the ones you want to focus their attention and resources. And so if you take away their requirements for them to go and chase down, you know, people with marijuana, then they can focus it on the other people that are really the bad guys. And then also if you give them more resources as a result of that, then you can, you know, you give them even more resources to go
right.
chase those bad guys. Plus what you're doing too is you're taking $1 billion a year out away from those bad guys, right? Like the cartels and the drug dealers, the cartels and the drug dealers are those bad guys. They're
right.
the ones that are running, that are funding all this stuff. And so when you take away $1 billion a year, that makes their enterprise a lot less profitable. And so they're not going to have the money to buy the guns and buy the bullets
right.
and, you know, pay off all everybody they need to pay off. So I think it would make, you know, a significant improvement in the safety just across the board.
That's another one of those unique little avenues that are not noticeable until we talk about it like this.
Yeah.
You know, another argument is that, of course, you know, when the government gets involved and the government's regulating everything, it really messes things up. And so, of course, right now, marijuana not being legal, you know, people can't really use it. But, of course, the fear from what I've heard is once government gets involved and then they start regulating it and they start, you know, judging mm-hmm. it or whatever the case may be, it's going to mess it up.
Yeah, so I mean, I think it's, I agree with you. I think there's a continuum, right? So right now you have the maximum amount of government involvement because
right.
they prohibit it and they'll throw you in jail if you do it or sell it, right? And so
spending resources on
marijuana
that they could be spending on finding the really bad people.
Exactly. And so you have the most government involvement right now. And so if you say, well, the government's going to regulate it, then really all they're going to do, I mean, in my model anyway, is going to have anyone can, if they, as long as they pass a minimum background check, and they're not selling in a drug-free zone around a school or whatever, like anyone can open it. There's unlimited licenses, right? So it gives a lot of opportunity. It lets the free market really decide, you know,
right.
who the winner and losers are versus the government picking them, which I think is a big problem. And that's why, like in California, I think 75% of the marijuana sold in California is on the black market. And it's because they put all these restrictions and regulations and burdensome taxes that couldn't wipe out the black market, right? So people are just decide, hey, look, I'm just going to use the black market. It's already established and it's a lot cheaper. So.
Yeah.
It's one of those things where you really have to, I think, rely on the free market to solve some of those problems. At the same time, the government can set up a very basic structure to allow that free market to grow. And especially in the case of marijuana, where people are comfortable with, hey, look, this is going to be safe. You know, this isn't going to hurt my family. This isn't going to do anything. That's really going to be something that's going to be positive for the community. So I have my legalization bill is not only going to be decided by the people, but it's also very free market. So it allows those people and individual entrepreneurs to come up with the solutions.
So let's talk about that, about the election part of it then. I mean, of course, this is our next legislative session. If this gets passed in the legislature and the governor signs it, then when will the people see it on a ballot? How long will that take?
So right now, the next regularly scheduled statewide election is not until fall of 2022. So that's what it says in the bill. But I'm pretty sure there's going to be a statewide election before that, and I'm going to amend the bill so that it basically, as soon as there's a next election, that this will be on the ballot.
Okay.
And so I don't know if that maybe could be fall of this year, so fall of 2021. Or maybe spring of next year. I think that there's a lot of constitutional amendments that are coming up this session that I imagine we're not going to wait, you know, a year and a half to hear.
Right.
So I think that
more constitutional amendments?
Yeah, well, that's welcome to Louisiana.
We had seven of them last year.
Welcome to Louisiana. We have a bunch of constitutional amendments. Yeah, that's another problem for another day. But we have a big burdensome constitution that really ties our hands. And so that's part of our problem. But yeah, I think with those other amendments that are kind of tangential, not part of this, but when they're holding the elections for those, I think we can use this as another thing we can put on that election.
How do you think this is going to fare out in the legislature? Do you think that the legislature is favorable to it? I mean, I know, what's the percentage of Louisianans that you say are favorable?
Two-thirds. Yeah.
Two-thirds. So what about the legislature? Are you getting a feel for that?
So I obviously I'm in the House of Representatives. The House of Representatives, I think, is particularly favorable to it, which is interesting because I would say a lot of people think it's more conservative of the bodies.
Right.
But the Criminal Justice Committee, which I sit on, which this bill is probably going to go to, I think I'll be able to get out of the committee, which will be the first time a marijuana bill ever gets out of the committee.
Right.
And then I think on the House floor, I think I probably have a pretty good shot at getting it out of there too. The Senate is kind of a different animal. I don't really know. You know, we'll see how it goes. I think a lot of it's going to depend on how the public pushes people. Honestly, calls, if they all call their senators and say, hey, this is something we really believe in. At the end of the day, we all work for the people.
Exactly right.
We all work for the people. Representatives and senators, it's the people we represent are the ones we work for. So I think if they get out and they tell us, hey, this is what we want to happen, if those two-thirds of people all pick up their phone and call their senators, I think it would probably go through.
67%, I think you said, right?
Yeah, 67%. So it's not even close.
That's a big number.
Yeah.
So is there anything else for this session coming up that you think that you want to get out, any word you want to get out?
No, I mean, I think it's a fiscal session, so it's a lot mostly focused on the kind of fiscal matters. We're going to have a ton of money from the federal government that I guess we have to figure out how to spend. Pray we spend it wisely. That's all you can say.
Hopefully we spend it on one-time projects opposed to building government and making government bigger.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, I think if we could pay off, I mean, Louisiana owes a lot of debt. So if we could pay off debts, that would probably be a wise way of doing it so that we can... not give our children the debts that we've inherited, right? So
too bad we can't take some of that COVID money, and just say, hey, look, take the part of this of the wildlife fund that we got to pay back. Was it $400,000 this year?
For the levees in New Orleans?
Exactly.
Yeah. No, it's a lot. I think it's like $1.2 billion or something like that. Significant amount.
And it's another one of those significant loans that not many people realize it. I try to mention it in my videos because not a lot of people know about it.
Yeah.
And it's something that's another one of our burdens that we got to watch out for now.
Yeah.
Well, Representative, thank you so much for coming on today.
Well, no problem.
I really appreciate it. No. And look, I want to tell everybody else, if you like the video, if you feel that you got some good information out about the legalization of marijuana here in Louisiana, then share it. Is there any calls that they should make or anything about it? You think the people should call the legislators?
Yeah, call your representative, call your senator, call your sheriff, because the sheriffs are all involved as well. Call them all and tell them how you feel about it. That's the most important thing.
And spread the video, share the news, and thank you so much for watching, and tune in for the next episode coming up really soon. Thank you all very much.